The Pit of Ultimate Dark Shadows, Episode 13. A Balancing of the Humors. Dedication. Though you may never hear this, Catherine Lee Scott, née Kringstad, actress, writer, and anecdotal marvel, this one is for you.
Good evening, and welcome one more time to the Pit of Ultimate Dark Shadows. I am your host, Sir Simon Milligan, and we know that this episode is likely the one you want to get through quickly. So I shall dispense with introducing my trusty manservant. Oh, all right. Have it your way. This is all for you in the audience anyway. Manservant Hecubus!
Thank you. I'm here to serve my master. And you! Our audience, who likely enjoys darkness and a little something extra that goes with it.
Now, what is in the cards for tonight's episode?
Well, we have a rather dazzling display for you this time. Both dramatic and, well, a few chuckles to be had. As Wadsworth has disappeared from Cullenwood, not that his master minds, it seems that he has struck up an evening with Professor Stokes and spent time relaxing at his home to defer various stresses caused by the bouncing kitties at their romp in the old house.
Aye, love them as we might. The noise is a bit troublesome to the nerves, even for such a well-cut man as our servant, whom we still haven't squared down as either a valet or butler, but as you've seen before, we have made quite a combination of things in this little pit of ours.
There is also a small matter of Caleb Collins, master, and if Tom Jennings will make the introduction Cousin Lily suggested to Elizabeth Stoddard.
Yes, I have a feeling he has a few cards up his sleeve, or maybe somewhere else on his slightly solid, slightly transparent person. But now, we must endure more drama, and perhaps a few platitudes, as Hoffman and Barnabas are in one of their usual uproars about who he loves and why. This, of course, has to do with the shocking discovery that not only are Maggie Evans and Josette Dupres the same, but that he managed to injure them both due to his transformation of being one of the undead. What with being fairly out of his mind both times, this series of events is beyond embarrassing.
How could this have happened? Why didn't I know? I thought perhaps there was some kind of possession of Josette's spirit in there now. But this is beyond reason.
Again? Really? I've explained it as best I could, and even I don't half believe it after having seen it all for myself. I mean, if she was Josette all along, why didn't something trigger her coming out on her own?
In all of my days, and all my foul actions, I harmed her. I sent her away. Whatever powers she would have to help me, I ended when I re-entered this house. I told her I claimed this house as mine. Her and my father's power had ended. I declared I was free to live the life I never had. Whatever that may turn out to be.
I see. Well, it turned out to be fairly ironic from the sounds of it. You banned Josette's spirit from the house, didn't you, Barnabas? If you did that in all your petty angst, how would Maggie have any triggers to remembering a previous life?
Yes, I did. For which I hope my heart may spoil.
Oh, stop that self-defeating aggrandizement, Barnabas. However much it suits you, the two of you are simply going to have to live with this. Now, what results do you expect from all of this?
She'll likely come out with the sheriff, and that would be fitting.
I don't think so. She knows too much, and she knows it's too complicated.
Of course she would. She's always been that way. What else did she say on this?
She kept going on about what was important under any circumstances. She was clearly concerned over how horrible you had turned out. But stranger, between both lives, was her anger that you didn't care about who she really was. And she said, what would be more important than the human soul?
Of course, she would say that. So long have I been persuaded by her intellect, her ingenuousness, and yes, her wit. But the spirit of her, the talent she has had for delighting in things of all matters, large and small.
How can you say that? What on earth do either of those girls have placed upon you? Why do you throw yourself into this companionship for so little?
Little?
You wanted a china doll, Barnabas. When have you ever wanted anything more than that? What does Maggie or Josette place on you? Why do you always go on about her so much?
My mind was lost to me when I came out then. But I went back to her, because it was her sense of the divine.
You're joking. You continually go on about how perfect that damsel in distress is.
No!
Well, why do you go on about her perfection so much?
That's not what it is. She has something more than that.
How dare you? How can you claim that? And what the hell do you want with her anyway? She's likely cast you off as a man with no heart. I am so tired of the perfection you already place on Maggie and Josette. I'm tired of it. Why didn't you just let a story stop where it should stop? You already let Victoria go. And then you went back to Maggie again, after I explicitly forbid it.
And how did that happen, Doctor? Why didn't I listen to you?
Because you were so confident that I would do nothing when I told you to stop seeing her again.
Are you so sure that was me? Maybe having to confront her at that cost made all the difference.
I have really had it. What in damnation is so perfect about her?
I told you. It's not perfection. It's the divine.
Oh, horse shit! I've been speaking to the both of them all night. What the hell is it about either of them that is so damned perfect?
I didn't say perfect, did I, Doctor? I said divine. Oh, don't you even know what that means?
Well, not what you mean by it, for all my imagination.
Then it's not as fruitful as I thought.
Oh, don't you sidestep the issue with me, Barnabas Collins. I told you that I talked to the both of them all night, and I have a pretty good idea what makes either of them tick.
Then I envy you dearly, Doctor, for it is hard to explain what her own spell has cast over me.
Spell? You speak as though she were the real witch here.
Perhaps she is. Or did that never occur to you?
Do you really feel anything for either of them?
Everything.
Did you think I wanted to make her into a mold cast of the perfect woman? Did you think I wanted to suspend her from a diamond chain to wilt as so many other women of that day and age? Awakening in this lifetime was beyond my expectations, and I've had to ask myself repeatedly why I continued wanting her, and only her. Why would I have risked what I'd already gone through with her if it wasn't for something else?
Oh, and what was that something else? To make more Collins offspring and perpetuate the madness of this estate?
No. To change it.
What? Change it? Well, a lot of women could do that. Is that what you want?
I see where your thoughts lie. Now, take my hand, Julia. You've been a friend and faithful companion. But look into my eyes and tell me honestly. Do I love you as more than a friend? Or above this estate? No. And honestly, do I care for you resembling in anything close to how I love her? No. And therein lays the difficulty and the impossibility.
But what do they... What does she have that wins your heart? Really?
Could it be nailed down to one thing? If you want more than beauty, charm, generosity, then how about humor?
Humor? Are you out of your mind? That's it?
And what propels us beyond the absurd, Doctor? You tell me, humor or drama? And what else would change the diabolical austerity of this estate? The drama or the humor?
Damn you. How did you come to that conclusion after all these years?
I knew it before. I knew it at home here, and with my parents, and with all this place stood for. And I saw it again when I came back. Now, Doctor, do you see the point?
I do. But I don't have to like it.
Exactly. And what do you think about my choices now?
That you've turned out far better than I ever gave you credit for.
Thank you. I have been very fond of you, too.
Well, then, tell me this. When you married Angelique, did you ever think she could have made those changes?
Do you think she ever cared for other people above herself? Really?
Not from the sounds of it. Not at all. And I guess, Josette.
Precisely. She did. As does Maggie. And this is the point. The estate, family, both, or myself. What would all of that be combined without her?
I see.
Shall I expect Mr. Evans to come over with a revolver?
Well, he's sobered and situated. I don't think there's too much danger of that, surprisingly.
We can only hope.
What? Are you serious?
Never mind. Now, what about Maggie? Even with all her knowledge and understanding, any glimmer on that account?
You ask too much of me. I don't know her future thoughts. I've merely unlocked her past ones.
If only I knew what she went through, perhaps I could.
I think it's time that I was alone again. But I do thank you for all that you've done. It must have been terrifying. And if I had been there, my presence would hardly have improved the circumstances.
Barnabas, are you going to be all right?
Dr. Julia Hoffman, I have my sister again. My family. What more can I ask for?
And so Dr. Hoffman very reluctantly leaves the old house with certain plans to request assistance from another friend. Meanwhile, the friend she's looking for is a little busy. Professor Stokes and Wadsworth are now within Wincliffe Sanitarium after coming to an understanding during the previous evening.
I must thank you again for the generous offer to stay in your home, Professor Stokes. I have to confess, I was getting a bit affected at the old house.
That's just as well. It was worth it to have all this explained. From what Dr. Hoffman told me about Mr. Loomis, I was pretty sure I'd found the right man. That Willie certainly has a peculiar history.
And don't I know it. But, sir, are you sure this will work?
I have little doubt about it. You have managed to perform some miraculous feats since you arrived at Collinwood, Wadsworth. I think Mr. Loomis, being able to see you, might do the trick, indeed.
Ah,
Mr. Loomis, you look well.
Why, thanks, Professor. I am a little weary of the pen now.
Then I'm happy to inform you of a visitor.
Someone you might know. And I will leave you two alone to resolve everything.
Well, don't I know you?
I'm afraid you may. Does the name Wadsworth have any special memories, Mr. Loomis?
Wait just a second. Now that was a long time ago. You can't be bothering me with all that now. I did like you asked me, and I stayed out of that house.
Yes, you did, Mr. Loomis. And that was all for the better as far as things go. As it turned out, almost every single person who came to the door was killed.
Now, you must be pulling my leg.
And no surprises that you hightailed it out of there when the chief arrived.
Hey there. You see, you never told me no cops were coming, did ya? Did ya? Yeah, 'cause you knew I wouldn't have stayed long if I'd have known that.
Well, they weren't there for you, of course.
So, why are you here anyway? Happy to see me locked up with the key thrown out?
No, Mr. Loomis. I'm here to help.
Help? How do you plan to do that? With a guy like you doing out here anyway? Got a job at Collinwood or something crazy like that?
Yes.
What? Oh, then you're obviously here to stay and be my bunkmate, aren't you? The place is more Looney Tunes than here. Must have made even you all cracked up. Although, I gotta say, I'd rather be there than here sometimes.
Mr. Loomis, I know this may come as a surprise to you, but I actually have a job at the old house of Collinwood.
No. That's impossible. Why, you... How could you... You don't look bruised at all. You can't be as cool and easy as I knew you. If you're working for Barnabas Collins.
But I am.
and there have been quite a number of changes there for the better.
Now you gotta really be joshing me. There's no way all the problems could ever be solved out there. Not even half of 'em.
Oh, you'd be surprised, Mr. Loomis. We men of service have our secrets, don't we?
Service? Psh! I'm more of an odd job man.
Ah. It seems that would have changed as well. I've kept tabs on you in one way or another. When I heard you coming together with that character, Maguire, I was sure it was all over for you. But then, I heard you were practically a man of all work later. Something had turned around. I almost wanted to come out here then and see for myself. Of course, the other news came out, and then I knew for sure. I had a job lined up.
Oh, so keeping tabs on me to steal my job, eh?
No, not exactly. But I was quite curious as to why you'd gone down such a bad path again, after changing direction as you did. Plus, from what I heard about the Collins family, and all its unbelievable circumstances, I knew it was the proper place for me to come.
So that's it, is it? Well, you must be as out of it by now as I got. With all that malarkey going down around there. I know you thought you could do some good at Hill House, and maybe you did. I've had to deal with some blackmail in my time. It ain't the nicest thing to do to people.
Well, I'd say I managed to at least straighten out that trouble for 5 people out of 6. Those are hardly bad figures.
Oh, yeah? Well, what a shock to discover I helped with something that turned out well. But Collinwood, that place is something else. You know that Barnabas is a, well, a vampire.
Less so now, I think.
Oh? And there's that Roger Collins. He's really uptight.
Not anymore.
Oh, well, how about that Carolyn, eh? Still flinging the boys away?
No, Mr. Loomis.
Well, what about Maggie's father in town? Sam Evans? Is he still drinking up all the booze at the Blue Whale? He's probably dead by now.
You are incorrect about that, too.
Have you even been to Collinsport, Wadsworth? There is no way that place could ever be happy. No way. I was there, and I know. If what you're telling me ain't scat, you have got to be from another planet altogether.
Can you keep a secret?
Yeah, I know, and so can you.
If you can't believe me, Mr. Loomis, whom can you believe? I may not have told you some things, but I don't remember ever lying to you. I thought that would have helped.
Maybe it did for a while. You are such a darn charmer, you. Yep. Guess you ain't planning to pay for all the work I did. Or the fact that those pesky dogs just about tore off my pants as I left.
If you like, I will be pleased to acquire a new set of trousers for you. And yes, seeing you better would make me very happy to reimburse you for the amount I owe. And perhaps a little more besides, say, as a bit of compound interest.
Well, you are full of surprises. You might as well shock me into having to stay here longer.
That's my concern, Mr. Loomis. If you were all right, you could come back with me. I think it's become a much nicer place than you remember.
What? No more spooks?
Well, perhaps less volatile ones. Now, I'm not saying all was perfect, but I think you've been dearly missed.
If you are telling the truth, I'd be game. But there has to be something else to it than that.
Yes. We will have to allow our employer to make up his mind, as well as the staff here. But there is a challenge you will have to comply with.
I knew there was a catch. Oh, yeah. I just knew it.
Can you imagine living in a good place, Mr. Loomis?
No. Actually, I can't. Do you want me to try?
Would you be willing to live in a place that could be good if we worked hard to make it that way?
You gotta be kidding me. Really, Wadsworth, you have got to be kidding me.
Looks like our Wadsworth had a little something up his sleeve he didn't tell anyone.
Not only that, Master, he lied!
Oh, well, perhaps it was more kept under his bowler hat than anything else. As far as I can recall, he told Roger Collins that he didn't know Mr. Loomis at all. And when it comes down to that, who really does?
Aw, I was hoping there was a little spark of something in our trusty butler.
You mean evil? Well, there would have to be some knowledge of it if he managed to see Mr. Collins through the Adam and Dr. Lang period,
of which we feel no real need to explore.
Yes, Master, and that in itself is a little bit evil, isn't it? Our next stop explores the Evans home briefly, to see how our reincarnated Dupres are comprehending things.
Well, it's good to hear you laughing again. What a wild ride this has been. And a lot more to share on our old days, eh? Yes. Looks like we've been around a lot longer than we thought.
And I understand how this could make you want to experience it with someone. It's too spectacular to be easily ignored. Why could it be that we, or maybe I should say I, keep on coming back?
Well, I'm not sure you're ready for that information. I know I see it as something that needs to be straightened out. Not with him.
How I could ever trust him again escapes me.
Josette Dupres, you and I know. People can change. They really can. There has to be some reason the two of you keep trying through the ages, and also without knowing it.
I don't think so. But someday, I think I will have an answer to what's really been bothering me about all this, at least in the long run.
The very long run.
Yes. But right now, all I can think of is that dark place and that room, which is confounding because as scary as it was, another part of me misses it for the first time. I was really there. And I have to admit, I miss the crate, too. I keep itching to go through it. After all this time, knowing it's still there. But that's not going to happen now.
Well, if nothing else, I'm sure we can have it sent. There's no doubt about it now. Everything in there is obviously yours. And he's got to know that by today.
I'm going to sit on the porch for a while. I need some fresh air to think about all of this.
Sounds good. But Maggie, can you put something else into your thoughts while you're out there?
Sure, Pop. What is it?
He didn't do all those terrible things because he wanted to. He did them because that friend of yours, Angelique, was no friend at all. What she managed to do would set anyone to madness. She wanted him. Destroyed both of our families. Even if some was by proxy. And all because he didn't love her. He loved you.
All right, Pop. I'll add that to the pile.
Ah, the Evans have deep troubles indeed. It will be interesting to see how they continue on in this manner. Now, on to our three individuals of the previous evening, who are entering the Seaview property in the hopes to find a ghost of crusty persuasion.
Mr. Collins. Mr. Collins?
Well, that sounds promising.
Good job, Mr. Jennings.
I think you knew what your role really was in all of this.
Hey, now, Mr. Collins, wait a second.
Stop worrying, Tom. You'll get a headache.
Of course I still admire you. And your gumption. It's only natural.
All right, Mr. Collins. I'll get back to the cans.
Oh, Mr. Collins, we've been wondering. We have a dilemma, and perhaps you could help us.
Duh. I am a ghost, after all.
Oh, I knew that. I have the utmost admiration for specters willing to do good.
Good? In Collins' part?
You really aren't a resident, are you, Mrs. Moinster?
Oh, that's Munster, Mr. Collins.
Why do you even go by Munster? That's a French cheese. And your husband had relatives from England, right? Shouldn't it be Moinster?
Oh, I see your trouble there. It's, well, a little detail that got confused on Ellis Island.
Of course, it would be. Now, as for you, my little mistress of the estate.
Oh? Uncle Caleb, were you speaking to me?
Ah, good. You're still as wondrous as ever, little Lizzie Collins.
And you're just as kooky, if I know the family history well at all.
Oh, yeah. You do. I know if you had the nerve to come and speak to me, there might be something right going on around here.
I have earned a little stamina in my time, and I fully understand what it's like to be a recluse, as you may well know.
Oh, don't I?
Yes, you've impressed me.
Cooping yourself up almost as well as I've done. Of course you impressed me!
Well, I'm sorry if any visitors here have caused you to be anxious. I can see why it might have done.
Uh-huh.
Eh, I know. That Victoria you hired. What an ironic circumstance. I have to wonder if you picked her for David's governess on purpose.
No, Uncle Caleb. Well, not exactly. And I must ask, what interests you about her anyway? She can't have been in this house more than thrice.
I overheard those two bickering over the fate of her at the bottom of my stairs. Both seem pretty protective.
Which two do you mean, Uncle Caleb?
That Barnabas and Buck Devlin. Coming in here and sparring words like there were two rival brothers over one damsel. That was hilarious for me. I knew the history and fate of both of them at the time. Hilarious, I tell ya!
What were their fates?
Oh, little Lizzie.
Buck Devlin, you know. But that Barnabas. Sheesh! I could even call him my uncle! What a twisted spectacle of problems he's got!
Well, Uncle Caleb, suppose we forget about the rest of our certain family for now, and concentrate on the unknown among them. Yes?
Smart girl, Lizzie. And you always were. Why do you think I've been holding on to this house for so bleeding long? Why do you think I've been watching you? And her? Why do you think I've been keeping all them soda bottles in the... Well, maybe that's neither here nor there.
Uncle Caleb, I've come this far in believing the outrageous. Can you tell me? Is she mine?
Of course she is, Lizzie. At least as far as I can figure.
Well, is there anything else you can tell us?
Looking for Leslie, aren't you? Had the time of your life in New Brunswick, didn't you?
Oh, Mr. Collins,
"It wasn't like that. There is such a thing as permissible passion, you know."
"And aren't you the proof of it, Miss Drake?"
"Oh, well, I suppose I did a bit of encouraging. You can blame me if you want. Wait, I haven't used that name since we went on that trip."
"Uh-huh. I've seen your collection of passports, and you might as well use the name and face on that one as not.
None of your English relatives want to recognize you anyway.
Make yourself inconspicuous, girl."
"Oh, well, I'd been planning on it, Mr. Collins."
"Uncle Caleb, can we please stick to the point? If you can't help us, I won't know if anyone else can."
"Ask me anything you want, little Lizzie. As you can see, I ain't going anywhere."
"And why not?"
"It's one of the standard contracts of the underworld. 100 years, in or around your own home. At least most of the time. And I knew that. I tell you, I knew that when I made out that will."
"All right. Let's say I believe you. Do you know how Victoria is doing?"
"Doing marvelously well, my dear. And sure to be on her way home soon."
"Good. And now, where is Leslie?"
"Why do you want to know about him, Lizzie? I already told you, Victoria is yours, or as good as yours. I knew she'd want this place, and I knew she'd be ready for it by the time I was almost prepared to leave it."
"Well, Uncle Caleb, you made out the will, didn't you? Don't blame me if I have to prove that she's worth it."
"You got me again, little Lizzie Collins. I know, it's all my fault. As well it should be. He's in England, and always was from there." "Just like your cousin Barnabas is not."
"Oh, Uncle Caleb, I don't care right now. Why must you go on about him so?"
"It's hard not to.
Well, he's got me curious.
Lily!" "Smart girls, smart girls. I always liked them, when they didn't interfere. Now, you mark your maps for Dover, you see. Check the military registry, and there you'll likely find your Leslie."
"Thank you, Uncle Caleb."
"Just hold it, dear."
"What is it?"
"You were right. Not to tell your father. I wanted you to know that."
"Really, Jameson?"
"He would never have approved. Noah understood. And wrongly so."
"You can blame it on young Quentin's influence if you want. Heaven knows he had enough indiscretion in his life."
"Yes, I had a feeling. I do thank you, most sincerely, Uncle. Now, anything else we should know?"
"You'll want to get out of here soon. You girls don't need more to worry about with the pesky gargle of flotsam that's going to occur soon."
"Oh, now, don't look at me like that."
"I tell you, it's not going to make a peck of difference whether you're here for it or not. It'll just fret you more, and you have your own things to take care of."
"You are most kind, sir."
"Yeah, yeah. You take good care of her. This time, fromage." "Ah, Lizzie. My little sweet petunia."
"Did you say something, sir?"
"Yeah. How about I help you out with sorting those things? And you can tell me about your family. At least, the parts I don't know."
And later, in Dr. Hoffman's office, which keeps collecting dust.
"Hello. I don't work here."
"Well, thank goodness you answered the phone. I've been calling all over the place for you. Professor, could you come to town right away? I'm very concerned about one of my patients, and it's a long way for me to walk."
"Well, I did have to look out for another person I brought here,
I suppose I could have Miss Jackson let him know he can stay in your office.
Yes, I'll ring her and let her know. I'm at the Collinsport Inn. Please hurry.
Oh, dear, that sounded scary. However, we need to take a glimpse at the Adams family homestead, as Morticia is helping Victoria to learn some handiwork of the home economics variety.
Fester.
Say, Victoria, we're putting new metalworks into the beds today. Want to see how the frames can sometimes magnetize against my skull? It's a lot of laughs.
Victoria, uncertain whether to chuckle or scream.
I'm a little busy here. Perhaps later.
I'm not sure how you all survive, Mrs. Morticia.
But I must say it's a lot more warm-hearted here than where I come from.
Oh, my dear, Collinsport has a warm heart, actually. It just hides it so much. It's simply afraid of itself, in many ways, as we are not.
Oh? How do you know that?
A lot of contagion. Some of that haughty behavior from one person can make others respond as though they truly do have something to hide, when they never would have thought so at first. Can you hand me the tassels, dear?
Here. I don't understand. You mean when one person behaves haughtily or insinuating, the others do as well?
It doesn't start like that. It usually begins with someone in authority doing so to others. Eventually the response comes as deep self-consciousness, worrying over themselves. Then it can twist into domineering actions over others, looking to eke out the same response in someone else. I think Collinsport only needs a little help. If only I could have provided that.
Well, again with that face, Victoria. Didn't you already make a few changes? I think your arrival there opened the people up somewhat. But the world is a big place. Resting it on your shoulders isn't wise, you know.
You're right. In fact, now that I think about it, perhaps I managed to even change its past.
Oh? Have you seen even more of that place than you let on? Perhaps
its history? Well.
Now. No need to be coy. You're not in Collinsport any more.
Well, you see, we were in the middle of a seance, and something very strange happened. It wasn't a long time for anyone else in that room, but it was for me, and I was propelled, I guess you could say, into the past.
Oh? Really? Really?
Then I had to truly endure that estate's history and find out all kinds of things.
Oh, my. Oh, my.
Oh, Morticia, I know it's absurd, but you did want to know. I can see I've made you think I'm crazy or something.
It's not that, my dear. Oh, my. Grandmama! Grandmama!
What is it, dear? Don't get so flustered. Unless you're enjoying it for the moment.
We need you, Grandmama. It's Victoria. She has the gift.
And, upon hearing this startling discovery, we lead you to the old house again, where Professor Stokes awaits the doctor's prognosis over her patient by his car, as Hoffman and Barnabas square some things away.
Well, I suppose it is for the best. I never did believe I would be alive for so long. And it would be a good thing at this point, now that I see the family has improved. It has been quite a journey we've taken, Doctor. Julia.
Oh, Barnabas. Damn you in this depression that's taken hold. What on earth can you be talking about? It's not like there is no hope at all.
Oh, I do have hope. But not about her. However, Maggie's own experience has taught me that if nothing else,
There are other avenues of existence to explore, and I think I've held them off for long enough.
You mustn't speak like that. This life still has joys to show you, and you know that!
It has other joys to show, but not as who I am now.
I should have stood my ground when it came to Maggie. That ridiculous bet! So absurd!
This is no game of cards. At least if I were out of the way, I could be with Sarah. For good.
Where are you going?
I am going to find out for myself. Precisely what Josette went through.
No! Come back here! Oh, forget it. Who the hell ever responds to that one?
Doctor, where has he wandered off to?
There's no time. We have to hurry.
Dr. Hoffman, what has possessed you? Slow down!
Chalk it up to the Hippocratic Oath if you want. What doctor has ever dealt easily with losing a patient?
You mean, he's going to...
Yes.
Then why not follow him and restrain the man?
That's what I aim to do.
But this isn't following him.
I know.
Dr. Hoffman? Professor Stokes? What in the world?
No time to explain. We need you, now.
For what? What's happening?
I'll explain in the car.
I'm afraid it's a matter of life or death, Miss Evans.
Life or death? Whose?
Please. There isn't much time and the doctor is most determined.
Here, Maggie. Take your coat. I think you should go with them.
Pop? Do you know anything about this?
Allaire, vite.
What? What a trick to play on me! Why should I care about Barnabas Collins? The man kidnapped me and then tried to possess my mind!
Maggie Evans, as your physician, can you honestly tell me that there isn't a spark of Josette Dupres left in you?
Enough not to want to be hurt another time. How could I ever forgive him? He never wanted a real woman anyway.
You're telling me.
What? Dr. Hoffman? You love Barnabas Collins too?
Oh, Maggie Evans. Who around here doesn't?
Too?
Why should you do this for me? Why for him?
Don't ask me. I'm a doctor, not a saint.
Angel of mercy, more like.
Can't you slow down? Where on earth are we going anyway? You've passed the old house.
To whatever dark shadow of Josette Dupres is left, I ask you, where would anyone go when faced with impossible la vie?
Widow's Hill. Oh... Dr. Hoffman, go faster!
Don't encourage her!
Watch out for the squirrel!
It's all right. I missed it. He's likely a Collins, too. Knowing this GD town!
Doctor, slow down or we'll go off the cliff! No, Julia. Wait here. She has to do this on her own.
But what if she can't... Huh?
Stay here, Julia. With me. They have to sort this out for themselves.
Elliot, is it me? Or have you never stopped serving the Collins family either?
Throw out all the speculations you want, Julia. I have a feeling I've been waiting to see this for a very long time.
Stop! Don't do it! At least, not yet.
Would you like to have the honors of pushing me over? You're entitled to it.
Not here to send you to your death.
No.
Nor am I here to save your life.
Well, then, what are you doing here?
I have one question to ask you, and it is one I have been meaning to ask you for over a century.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Say it.
Josette Dupres.
Face me, Barnabas Collins. Now answer me honestly. When you look at me, is that all you see?
What do you mean?
You heard me. When you look at me, is Josette Dupres the only thing you see? The only thing you want?
No.
Okay. And that's what I wanted to know.
Now, let go of me.
No, I won't.
Maggie, how can you? You could never forgive me, nor I myself.
Oh? You think I'd let anyone jump from this place after what I've been through?
Why not let me fall?
It's not the fall that hurts, Barnabas. It's the sudden stop. I know.
And do you think I don't deserve that pain?
Well, if it's pain you're after...
Maggie Evans!
I didn't keep that waitress job without a good right hook. Besides, you're not the only person around here who knows how to punish someone.
That says it all. Josette never had such a morbid sense of humor.
Oh? How did you ever know? You never stayed with me long enough to find out.
Well, would you let me this time?
Yes. I think I'd like that.
But now old friends are acting strange. They shake their heads, they say I've changed. But something's lost, but something's gained in living every day. I've looked at life from both sides now, from win and lose, and still somehow it's life's illusions I recall. I really don't know life at all.
All due respect to the kids in the hall. Clue, 1980s film, The Addams Family, 1960s TV show, The Munsters, 1960s TV show, and of course, Dark Shadows, 1960s TV show. Well, that's about 6 people and 3 relationships worked out. Now for the rest of them. Heesh. What a mess.
The Pit of Ultimate Dark Shadows is a Daryl War production.